When Steel Talks, everybody listens.
This is When Steel Talks, and we're really pleased to have the opportunity to sit down for a one-on-one with a championship-winning arranger by the name of Andre White. Of course, Andre, we know you very, very well from Yay High, but we've never actually had the time and the opportunity to sit down with you on a one-on-one basis. So welcome to When Steel Talks, officially. And I want to say congratulations first off for your championship win, New York 2011. But of course, we want to say the same for the UK Panorama just 1 week prior with the Mangrove Steel Orchestra. So it's
thank you.
2011, a fantastic year. I mean, it's got to be one for you.
Yeah.
So how has it been essentially for the last week? You know, time to relax after what has been obviously a very well time managed period before now.
It's been, I had like the first 2 days after Panama a lot of rest, which I needed because I had a cold for like 2 weeks, so I slept mostly. And then it's school now, everything's school.
Back to Berkeley for your
and
fourth year.
You know my mom.
Mom and grandma.
They're not making jokes. They say, yeah, congrats, but no.
Back to school.
Don't waste no time.
Indeed, indeed. So give us an idea of what your season has been like. I mean, it's been pretty hectic, obviously. You were in England for a period of time, and then you came back here for the last few days, just before the New York Panorama, to pull it all together for what turned out to be your second championship run. The first, of course, being in 2008.
Yeah, well, this season was long. Because start from Trinidad, I was long too. Because I took the semester thinking that, you know, knowing that it would be so long and that the whole carnival, I think it was March, right? Carnival was in March this year, something like that. And I took the whole semester off thinking, you know, I get to do just the work and you know, some things don't always work out in here.
What you have in mind?
Yeah. So, you know, the band didn't do as well as I may have thought. I got to stay though and enjoy carnival for
the
first time.
And you got more experience.
Right.
That's always a plus.
Right. So, you know, and I came back, I did a lot of practicing on my own. I had a couple of shows, one being the one Brooklyn Museum. Yeah, that was a good show too. Pretty much, that was it. It was just long, very long.
Okay. In 2008, when you went to the UK for, I would say, the first time with Mangrove, you had previously arranged the selection for Adlib Heat in just under a week back in February of 2008. That was a pretty quick arrangement at that time. Of course, your winning arrangement for New York Panorama 2008. What was the process like for 2011? Was it as quick when you did Do Something for Pan?
The band came to a decision on the song about a week before I had to go to England.
So this was a different timeline altogether.
Yeah,
but
I finished the outline, the frame of the song without enjoying it, that's what I mean, the body of the song, within that time. So by the time I left to go England, the song, they had been out about 8 minutes of music already.
Excellent. So therefore,
it was good to go. Yeah.
You've kept the same idea of just getting as much done before you travel to England.
Yeah.
What has been your experience in England since 2008 through 2011? I mean, you've bonded with the band, you've had that opportunity with Mangrove, they've given you the full support,
right,
as you've had here in New York with Adlib, and this year, a championship year at last. What was that experience like for both you and the band?
Well, it was it just felt good to achieve something that took them so long to get back to, you know, because Ebony is a very, very, very good band, and it's kind of when they're clicking and they're tight, it's very hard to beat. I wouldn't put that past them, but to know that from 2008, the first year I went there, the band only had about 30 players, because you know, going from Limburg C Sharp to Andre White, was like, come on, there's no comparison at them times. And it still isn't now, so it's like, You know, to get from 30 players to now being the biggest band on the night, 70, 75 players, was like, you know, a big success for the band. And then every year you found out the band would get tighter and tighter. As far as being a unit, being a unit, you know, respecting each other, respecting myself, respecting the management, respecting the players, you know. And it just every year kept getting better and better. Even last year we lost by a point. So it was like, wow, boy.
This year.
And we just finally, you
took
know,
it out.
Right over the edge, you know. So I like to say, you know, thanks to Mango again, boy, because an experience for him. And being over there is the next experience too, as far as music wise, you know. You get to just be hearing it differently. I mean, being in Brooklyn is nice, you know, you hear everybody's arrangements and it's one way of looking at the picture, but being in England, boy, they just have a different way of thinking about everything.
Take us through a little bit of that experience.
For me personally, it's a little bit more, they concentrate more on harmonically being challenging instead of like, you know, they take that, the approach of, you know, trying to embellish a song based on manipulating the harmonies around the song. Instead of, you know, where here is kind of similar, but not really. Here is more about, you know, how well you're going to be able to capture the crowd and, you know, try to develop basically more motivic ideas and melodically. But in England, they just have a different way of approaching their panorama songs, whereas they would take, you know, different harmonies around verse and chorus, and instead of only manipulating the melody, you hear them rehorn a lot more, and that to me is like, wow, bro, just hearing different colors, textures, intentions, and being able to, you know, see different outlines of where power music could be taken to, and I feel, you know,
so it's a
privilege to be out there.
It's a bit of a wider horizon,
right?
In that
definitely
case.
Definitely, and I feel that played a lot in me growing as a musician to what I am today, you know. And I'll not afraid to say I'm still growing. I think I'll be growing forever because of being able to travel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, world music is the only language being spoken by everybody.
Universal language.
Universal language.
Right. It's interesting. In 2008, you had just turned 18 in May, and that was a momentous occasion,
right,
a way of celebrating when you got the New York Panorama Championship together with Adlib.
Right.
This year, 21 years of age, and so you have another fabulous milestone for you to look back on. It's interesting how that has been working out. In terms of being with Adlib, since age 6, being introduced formally as their arranger back in 2006, it's been a really interesting journey for you. Hard work on the part of the band, but also yourself. For the benefit of the Word Steel Talks global audience,
mm-hmm,
just, you know, revisit how you got, you know, to the point where you are today with Adlib. You know, just in a few short sentences.
Well, like you said, you know, the band came a long way. I mean, I've been around the band, like I said, since 6, and I've been through the band with some tough times. But
some,
I mean,
crying tears.
Yeah, I was there, man. I used to cry. There was a time we came 10 3 years in a row.
Yes, and then you came 7th the next year.
Right,
that.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Man, I've been through. And so I started doing like some stateside music since like 2002. Like, you know, I'll sneak in a little song here and there and pull a couple of my little friends. You know, at that time we were like 12, 13. So, hey, come on, they time to do something,
mm-hmm,
man. And, you know, a lot of them, you know, yeah, we come and try something. Like 2004 now, I actually started doing mostly stateside music. And I find that, you know, started getting better and better and better. Started being easier to work with the players. And then time I still wasn't doing the music. I would always stay around like the arrangers at the time and,
mm-hmm,
you know, help them along with the song if they needed it. I would play anything and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And when it came down in 2006 now, the band kind of came into like a little riff. Whereas, you know, they were so unsure of to let me, you know, be a part of taking them there.
Yeah, you were only
so
15
young
at the time.
Yeah,
15 years old, people had some trepidation.
Yeah, you know, so.
But it was a good vote of confidence, given where things
right
are at.
Right, you know, again, thanks, you know, Franklin, Mr. Frank.
And on to Gene
and
Lisa.
You know, for
Lisa
giving me
the
support and
support,
the opportunity to,
mm-hmm,
to do what I'm doing today, you know. much respect to them. And from that year, it's like, you know what, it became 10 that year. And it was like, okay, but I worked with somebody. I worked with, I think his name, his name is Chalky, but he called, I think his real name is Michael George. We was calling him Chalky. And then he came the year after and said, you know what, I'm not doing this song. So let him do this song by himself.
And like, the next year it was a tie for third.
Tie for third, right. Mm-hmm. So it was like, okay.
So and then after that it was just, a championship. I mean, you just
went
on.
Going, yeah. Just keep going.
And 2009-2010 with Adlib, second place, right. Knocking on the door. And 2011, right. You restate that claim.
Right.
How does it feel? I know you said you're always still growing, but you're going up against your peers. You're still, at this point, the youngest arranger in the New York Panorama competition. And once again, together with Adlib, you have become the champion in the Panorama scene. How does it feel, you know, in terms of looking at your peers, the likes of UN Hopwell, you know, going up against a tried and tested set of arrangers, and there's some hard work and of course execution.
I mean, in every competition I go, I don't leave nobody to chance. Like, everybody's trying to put out their best. So, you know, my job is just to put out my best. You know, I always know that, you know, Popo's going to do his job. And he's going to do his job to the best he possibly can. Same thing for Arden. Same thing for all the veteran arrangers that's out here now doing things. So I always feel as if I can only do my best and do my hardest to, you know, keep a band successful and keep them in, you know, up there going, you know what I mean? As, you know, put out as much good music and make people, you know what I mean, feel good. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about Andre, the individual now. In 2008, you entered Berklee College of Music, so now you're going to be for your fourth year.
Yeah.
Fourth and final year. At your audition, they were essentially wowed by the possibilities and the potential of what could be done in the steel band instrument at your audition. It's been 3 full years. What has been the experience of Berklee been like for you and the relationship of the entire institution as a whole to the steel band instrument, given as well that there are other students who are there?
Well, for the record, Berklee has changed my life tremendously and opened my eyes to music in such a different ways. It's almost unbelievable. And sometimes I sit back and wonder, boy, I don't know what I'd be sometimes without being at school. And that's what makes me want to go back to school so much every time. Every time we have a break, I just want to be back at school, go back. And then at the same time, like you said, there's other people there that also keep me, you know, focused and driven to be better than what I am. Like Kareem Thompson and Iman Pascal, and you have Kay Shepherd, and you have, you know, what Sheldon used to be, Sheldon Twist, drummer. And he's also another big, big, big influence on me because he always keeps me growing. He always wants me to keep practicing, keep bettering myself, listening to different stuff
and
all the time.
Different possibilities.
Like I told you, I used to live with Sheldon actually. I was living with him the last semester, not just the last winter semester, living in, you know, we were living in an apartment together. And sometimes I'll get up about 10 o'clock in the morning, I'm hearing drums or bass or just rhythm is going. I'm like, this guy don't sleep. And I hear that.
If he's
not sleeping, I'm not sleeping. I'm getting up and I'm practicing. I'm going. I'm practicing something, whether it's drums, whether it's pan, whether it's keyboard. I'm practicing something because it just shows me that there's no rest to be. To be where you want to be, you can't rest.
You
to be successful, you got to keep practicing. Keep practicing. Just try to perfect your trade, man, because there's always, you know, opportunities out there. But when the opportunity comes, you want to be ready to do it. You know what I mean? They can't leave them the chance, and I respect him. Our next person, Kareem Thompson, man, I respect him a lot, man. As a musician overall, he's just amazing to watch him play. Sometimes he'd be playing, I just sit down and watch him. And we all, and what I like about the whole situation too, we all feed off of each other. Our next person, Brooks is at Berklee too, Earl Brooks Jr. Our next talented individual. KJ Marcel too.
It's an interesting time to be at Berklee College of Music. There right now there are several people, as you've just been mentioning by name. You have Earl Brooks Jr., you have Kareem Thompson, you have Sheldon Twaits, who's while he was drumming. He's finished at Berklee now, right?
Yeah,
Sheldon?
Yeah,
Sheldon is finished.
Yeah.
So therefore you still have KJ, you have Emando. There is a large number in terms of in comparison with the previous years, people who are actually using the pan as their primary instrument. What has that experience been like in terms of the feedback of other students at Berklee who are perhaps studying a conventional, quote-unquote, instrument, and from the faculty itself?
It's been, how do they say, a culture shock.
For Berklee?
Yeah, for Berklee, because a lot of the times they didn't realize what it could really do. Like
the potential of the stand-by instrument.
So I said, it's a lot, you know, sometimes we do jam sessions, and myself, Iman, and Kareem, and BJ will be there, and we'll be playing, and they'll just be like, wow. they can't believe that we're doing them kind of stuff
on pan.
You know?
So it's been an educational experience for Berklee, in a way.
So, and with that being said, it kind of advanced their process of evaluating steel pan players now, because when I came in it was like, okay, what can you do, instead of okay, this is what I would like to hear from you. That's what it's at now, because they know what we could do now. A lot of professors know where the pan, what the pan could play, and how it could work, and so they don't leave nothing to chance anymore. They want to test you.
Now it is a conventional instrument.
Right.
Everything is on the table.
Everything is on the table. So kind of in a way it's a very good thing. As a way, it made it harder for other people now. You know what I mean?
Who are coming into Berklee? It's no longer a novelty as far as the educators are concerned.
Right.
They have a
deep, bigger respect
significant.
For
understanding due to people like yourself, Iman, Kareem, this is pretty good.
Yeah.
In terms of composing, because you're also a composer, how much time have you had to compose? Are you still writing?
I'm still writing, actually. The funniest thing, I've been not writing any calypso, no pan or nothing.
A classical piece for your audition, so are you still
writing? I've been doing
a
lot of... While I was in England this past past 2 years now, I've been writing some pop / alternative / neo slow class R&B with this artist called Shaka Malcolm. He's a big artist. If he gets over here, he's gonna be big, and he's big in England right now.
So you've been writing for him.
Like he'll tell me, come in the studio, let's write something together. Not really write for him, because
it's a collaboration effort. Okay.
Yeah, sometimes I'll play drums on his on his tracks, and pan sometimes, and I'm always asking to play pan on his tracks. So whenever he wants me to, but it's working with him as well has been a eye opener for me, because I mean he's a genius by himself, songwriting genius. I've seen him write a song in 10 minutes. He just pull out his laptop and sing a whole, he'll sing just the bass line, he'll sing all the chords, he'll sing his part, he'll sing horn parts into GarageBand, and then come back and actually do it on Logic and play it out. He's amazing. I've been fortunate enough to come across some amazing, amazing musicians. And only 21 years of age, but
I
feel blessed.
You've accomplished a lot.
I feel really blessed.
So, fourth and final year at Berklee, a lot on your plate. You have a fervor, a passion for what you're doing. And such a young age, what do you see for yourself, say in about 5 years from now?
Everybody keeps asking me that.
Okay.
Saying, what are you going to do after college? I like arranging stuff, but it's never been something. I mean, I always wanted to do it, but I see it only as a limit, especially as panorama and stuff like that. But obviously, right now, my main thing is to, I keep saying, practice, because I want to start my own quartet soon. I have a lot of friends and musicians that
when Steel
are
talks,
definitely ready
behind
me. I want to do a couple of albums, I want to definitely...
You want to develop as an artist.
As an artist, I definitely want to, be in the circuit as far as jazz musician. You know, I wanna be there. I wanna.
Because you also, that was actually your bass in school, I remember.
Right, right.
And
right.
So you did piano. You also right. played the trombone at the time, and so
right.
you definitely have been inclined toward jazz.
Right.
For,
so that's the goal. And also with my major, I mean, my major right now is professional music, so I could do kind of like a little bit of everything.
Mm-hmm.
And with that being said, like, I think I might do some teaching after, like, just as a steady, you know, something just to keep me going from.
And to share
month.
What you've
right,
learned.
Right, exactly.
Today, yeah.
You know, some teaching, some way, somehow.
Okay, so this just really sounds good. I mean, you've got a lot under your belt, and still so much more to learn. And so, you've arranged in the three major panorama centers of the world, Trinidad and Tobago, the Mecca of Pan, New York Panorama, and of course the UK Panorama. Do you find either of the three more of a pressure situation than the other?
Well, I think that kind of question almost answers itself. I mean, Trinidad is a little bit, obviously, is the most pressure because it's everybody watching you, you know, to see what you're going to do. And you kind of have to meet the situation for yourself. You know, you can't, there's no, it's not like, you know, well, here, I think everywhere I've been, I've always had to make the situation for myself, you know what I mean? Whereas I never went into a situation where it was peachy clean for me and the band was perfect. And
mm-hmm.
I've always had to, you know, go in and work extra hard, you know what I mean? And
make it what you need
right,
it to be.
Exactly. Obviously in Trinidad it's a lot more difficult because you're coming in as a foreigner, as they would say, so you had to put in that extra effort to make sure that the judges hear you and remember you, you know what I mean? So that's always been a challenge.
Do you think since it's been a few years now in the New York Panorama Arena, is there anything that you're more comfortable with? We hesitate to use the term old hat, but is there anything that when you're actually going into the competitive season, knowing that it's another panorama, is there anything that you're more comfortable with now than you were back in 2006, for instance?
The only thing I'm more comfortable with is, as far as we're in New York?
Yeah, just to New York.
New York? I'm comfortable with the band. I mean, it's home. It's like, you know, I guess for these days, I don't go behind the band to do music anymore. I just stand up and call notes.
Yeah.
And it just comes from my head.
Yeah.
You know? But the band technically has advanced so much, you know? They could almost take anything, which I try not to overuse that privilege. You know, I try not to say, well, they can play anything, I'm going to give them anything.
And we should also state here for the audience that these people in Adlib are your peers who you've actually
right.
grown up with. These are Adlib
right.
was essentially a very young band
right.
at the time
right.
when you were 6 years old. There were
and
some adults, but they were basically youth
right.
just like yourself, so all have grown up together.
Right. So,
and so there's a mutual understanding, respect,
right,
and
right,
they've
right,
also
right.
gained skills along the way.
And with that being said, like it helps me to do music there because two things. Not only because they can play so extremely well,
mm-hmm.
they're such great players, but I tend to think that I give them the same amount of respect that they give me.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a firm believer of that. And I try to stress that to all the management that I come across in any band. You can't treat you. There's not enough money in the pan world right now to pay these players. And you know, shop. Mr. Sharp, the multi shop said that already. You don't have enough money to pay these players. All we could do is thank them and show them the respect that they deserve to be, you know what I mean, shown. Because at the end of the day, they're musicians in their own right. And they're the people that have taken on and dedicating their time, taking time out of their lives to come and do this
yeah.
for one night, 10 minutes of music.
And
you know?
Several weeks of practice.
Yeah. You know what I mean? You have to respect them. Give them a little, you know what I mean, something to show you appreciate them. You don't just treat them however you want to treat them.
Take them for granted.
Yeah, exactly.
The panorama, that's it.
You can't take them for granted.
Any words regarding Pan overall, this Philban art form and culture that you'd like to share? Anything that we haven't touched on, but, you know, burning issues?
One of the main things I've always wanted to say, well, for the longest time I've been saying, you know, I've had a lot of time to, you know, just think and like meditate about what this is really about and what's becoming, you know. And like I said in an interview actually after we got off stage, we have to maintain the music into this art form. I mean, obviously, you know, Paranormal is a show. People are paying money to see a show. But let's not only make it about the show. As far as musicians, the arrangers, and the bands, you know what I mean? It's always, it's nice to perform, but you have to give people, you have to, even if it's just a little bit, challenge the person's ear. You know, don't make it just very, you know, straightforward.
Formula.
Yeah,
to win.
Yeah.
You want to hear music.
Because a lot, you know, for me, it's starting to get monotonous, you know what I mean? And like I said in the interview, I mean, Sharp and Bootsy and Bradley, I mean Sharp and Bradley and Jitter, they didn't just start doing one thing over and over and they make the name just so. They did a lot of hard work to make this thing what it is now. And they did that like I said, by being them. They've always stuck to being them
and kept the music.
They didn't always outbeat each other, you know. Sometimes they try to outdo themselves.
Yes.
And try to, you know, push their limits and say, well, boy, well, what if I try this and take this here to that level and, you know, harmonically try to spread these chords this way or use these kind of tensions here. Or, you know what I mean? In this case, you know, and the different inventions that he uses, the different, you know, sequences that he retrogrades and, you know, those things made them who they are. And for me, that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to just, I listen to all of them, not just to, I don't take what they do. Yes, they are influenced, but you have to find something to say, well, what is going to make me, me? What is going to make Andre, Andre? What is going to stand out to say, well, yes, when I hear that band, I know that's Andre's work.
Andre's work,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because I could tell you, when I hear a band, I know when it's Bradley, I know when it's Jitter. Mm-hmm. It's just stuff that they do, you just know, you know what I mean?
Signature.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I was talking to, I think it was Iman, like the day before Paranormal, saying like, when I listen to other people's arrangements, I don't listen just like to actually what exactly they're playing note for note, and you know what I mean. I more listen to their orchestration, how they got the message across that they wanted to get across. You know, there's certain parts that they wanted to bring out, but for a reason. Why did they bring out that one part?
What picture, you know, were they painting?
Right, exactly. There's certain times where, you know, people may think it's by accident, but they're just not really listening to the whole picture that there might be a jam going on, but there's some kind of bass line will play something.
That's communicating.
Yeah, it's answering exactly what the front line just finished playing. You know, and some people are just not watching those big pictures. We're watching it too narrow, just too straightforward. Not everything that's in front of your face is just that. You had to watch the whole picture. And I try not to pay attention to too much of what, you know, critics would say about me, but somehow the only message I like to people just listen. Don't, not everything that's just, you're just here in front of you, it, listen, you know, because there's been, even last year now, I think it was Panami in New York, I did, one of the comments I got from some people was, I love this song. But in actuality, song is the right truth, it just, not every time you can play verse and chorus and tenors and double seconds. It can always be in the front. How to listen. Sometimes the bass will take the melody. Sometimes just the quads will take the melody. Sometimes just the 4 pounds will take the melody. Sometimes the tenor basses. Newest instruments in the band that carry different voices. You know what I mean? So you have to listen out. You have to listen deeper than what really is that you hear. I mean, you don't always judge a band's performance by what they're actually playing, because there's a lot of good bands that don't always get the numbers and get the actual performance to play, but they're playing some really great musical stuff. Don't look them over. I try to tell people that, don't look them over. So now I had to tell my mom and grandma, if she watching TV, all she want to hear is that. So now I want to hear everybody.
Indeed. Well, Andre, It's been really a pleasure to have had the opportunity throughout the years to just observe as you grew and developed and into this really cool guy to begin with, and of course to be a really credible arranger to be reckoned with. Congratulations on everything you've accomplished by your 21st birthday, and you have so much more to do, so much further to go. Congratulations once more, and of course congratulations to your mom and your grandma who are your driving forces behind you. Thank you for sitting with Wednesday Talks. It's back up to school,
thank you.
And we will be here waiting and watching.
Just want to give a special thanks to, like I said, all the management at Adlib and Mangrove,
Yes.
Mangrove Captain Andrew Casey, Matthew Phillips as manager, Miss Jean and Franklin Mayers, managers of Adlib, Joe Master Kinnear and Shelly, and everybody. Thanks for everybody for supporting me from day one, I really appreciate, just giving me the opportunity.
Thank you, Andre.
Thank you
very much. Thank you.
When Steel Talks, everybody listens.